Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever doesn't love doesn't know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Please be seated. Well, on behalf of the McCombie family, let me say thank you for everyone coming here today. We're here to worship. We are here to remember and celebrate a great man, a grandfather, a father, a pastor, a preacher, a friend, a mentor. My name is Sean Howard, and I have the privilege of being the minister here at St. Andrews. So Alex was my predecessor by one, two, three or four in front of me. And it's been a privilege to be here and to be part of this congregation, which he helped in many ways to build up in those formative years. What else was I going to? Oh, yeah, sorry. Gavin asked me just to mention a few of the connections between myself and Alex, and I don't want to go on too long, but they are quite many. I was actually a co-worker of Alex McCombie during his years at Knox, just for about 6 months or so, and it was wonderful just being able to get to know him a little bit in that way. But my family connection with Alex goes back into the 70s and 80s. My grandparents were members here at St. Andrews when Alex was here. And my grandfather was actually a mentor to Alex, because the connection goes back to the late 50s. My grandfather was the minister at Knox Church, Spadina. And Alex, as a student, connected with him there. So Alex, who was a mentor to many, was also mentored by others, and my grandfather, William Fitch, was one of those. So many connections. Just want to let you know a few things about how the service is going to proceed. Of course, as you just saw, when we are singing hymns, we're going to stand and sing for a couple more hymns during the service. And after the final hymn, "To God Be the Glory," I'll just ask you to please stay standing as we close out the service with the benediction and a closing solo. We will be saying the Lord's Prayer during the service as well, and if you are familiar with the words and would like to pray along, please do. I'll be using the words debts and debtors, just to give you a heads up about that, but you use whatever words come naturally to you. At the end of the service, there will be a recessional where our bagpiper will lead first the clergy and then the family, and then I would just ask you, please, one row at a time, starting from the front and going towards the back, to come out behind the recessional. And we're gonna be led up the stairs and into the gymnasium or the fellowship hall for a reception. If you're in need of the elevator, someone will be at the elevator to take you up to the fellowship hall afterwards, which is just to your left out the door there. So I just think that's everything to let everyone know about before we begin. Friends, we're here, as I said before, to remember, to celebrate, but also to worship. We're here to remember that God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea. And we hear, maybe we need those words of comfort. But also, and this would have been very key for Alex, friends, we are here to worship. We are here to give unto the Lord. In the words of Psalm 29, "Give unto the Lord, O you mighty ones. Give unto the Lord glory and strength. Give unto the Lord the glory due to his name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness." Our next hymn will be, "O Worship the King." Thank you. Please be seated. Let us pray. Eternal God, maker of heaven and earth, you formed us from the dust of the earth, and by your breath you gave us life. We glorify you. Lord Jesus Christ, you who are the resurrection and the life, you tasted death for all humanity, and by rising from the grave, you opened the way to eternal life. We praise you. Holy Spirit, author and giver of life, you are the comforter of all who sorrow, our sure confidence, and everlasting hope. We worship you. To you, O blessed Trinity, be glory and honor forever and ever. Amen. And now, friends, let us pray together using the words that our Lord Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Good morning and welcome. On behalf of the McCombie family, we want to thank you for coming and sharing this time with us as we all grieve and celebrate the life of Alex McCombie. But we also want to remind ourselves of this, that Alex's dad, granddad, like Ruth, mom, grandma, has fully discovered the one thing that he put his trust in, that he preached about, that he desired, this one thing that has now come fully true, that faith in Jesus Christ has opened up the doors to everlasting joy, eternal life, and the crown of righteousness, so that dad, granddad, friend, pastor is now saying, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award me on his day. Alexander McCombie, born January 29, 1930, to Mary and Bob McCombie. He absolutely loved his family. He absolutely loved his Scottish roots. He started life in Toronto and then continued on in Collingwood, where he met the love of his life, Ruth Collins. Together, not only did they share a passion for life, for music, but they made Jesus Christ the center. They set aside all other thoughts of career other than ministry together. Not only that, but they made big dreams come true, having the audacity to believe that when God said that heaven would be made up of all nations, he meant it for right now. They set about to get 6 kids from different nationalities, have 2 of their own, and then life, fun began. Or, you might say, messy family began. What do we want to say today that not only honors the one some of you know as Dr. Reverend Alex McCombie, others of us, dad, granddad? What do we want to say that speaks accurately of the friend, the mentor, the father, the grandfather that we remember? Some of the conversations that some of us as kids have had over in recent months has been noticing the breadth of friendship and influence that dad had. Now, this is something that you don't recognize as an 8-year-old or a 12-year-old. You don't even appreciate till you're about 58 years old. I want to take you as our beginning of celebrating dad through just a couple of his connections and the breadth of those relationships, how far they extended across our provinces. Starting with Cape Breton. After Mum's death 5 years ago, Jill and Paul brought Dad down to visit Fern, I, Malachi, and Joel. During his stay, Dad and I decided to take an adventure to one of his favorite spots, Bedeck, where Dad ministered at Knox Church and another small church right after he graduated from Knox. As we were staying in Bedeck one day, he asked me to take him to the gravesite because he wanted to go and see some of his good friends that had passed away. As we were looking at some of the names, a man in his early 70s came towards us. We thought he was a caretaker of the gravesite. He came up. Turns out he had just lost his mom. But he came right up to Dad. And without even saying anything else, he said, "Are you Alex McCombie?" Dad was surprised, although very pleased that someone had recognized him. He said, "How do you know?" He said, "You may not remember me, but I just lost my mother, and my mother was your organist when you were in Bedeck." Small world. The next day, Dad and I were having lunch at a restaurant in Bedeck. Dad was a bit low because he was starting to realize that the trip to Bedeck was as much realizing the people who had passed that he was not going to see again. He loved people. As we sat there, I overheard a conversation at the table next to me, a lady that started talking about Knox Church. So I'm the type of person that just starts the conversation. I leaned over and said, "I heard you talking about Knox. This is my dad. His name's Alex McCombie. In fact, he was a pastor at Knox years and years ago." She looked at Dad and said, "You wait here." She got up from her table, walked into another room in the restaurant. 2 minutes later, came back with 2 ladies. 2 ladies who had babysat our eldest brothers in Bedeck. It changed my whole dad's feeling that weekend as he connected in with old friends. My dad cherished his friends, and his friends cherished him. Let's talk a bit about the Sherbrooke connection. Fern and I and the boys moved to Dartmouth, Nova Scotia 14 years ago. And the first week there, it was beautiful out. We were walking around the neighborhood. And three doors down, a neighbor was moving gravel. And so I said to the boys, why not pitch in? Let's help him out. So we were. As we did that, another neighbor came out. And as we got talking, he mentioned that he'd lived in Sherbrooke, Quebec. He was an organist. And I said, that's interesting. I was adopted. My parents lived in Sherbrooke, Quebec, back in the mid-60s. And he looked at me and says, your mom wouldn't be Ruth McCombie, would she? And I said, well, how did you know that? Well, I ate at your parents' place so many times, and I took organ lessons with your mom. The influence, the impact, the connection that my parents had as they went along in life was incredible. Dad loved people. Malcolm, the organist, texted me this week sending his condolences with fond memories of both mom and dad and their goodness to him as a young organist. You know, Dad loved his ministry and the churches that he served in. As a family, this place, St. Andrews, was not only the place, the hallowed ground for our worship, but it was also our playground. It was also the place where we sang and learned music. It was where our good friends, as I see some of the friends that I grew up with here, is where our good friends were at. A few years ago, Paul and Jill were in Huntsville buying ice cream when someone tapped them on the shoulder and said, hello, Ian McQuinney. I haven't seen Ian in ages. They sat down together and had a lovely visit. During the conversation, Ian mentioned that he appreciated how Dad had affected his life, and Dad had also positively impacted so many other lives. Barry Morgan sent me condolences and said this, please take solace in this. I consider Dad, your dad, one of the most valuable leaders that I have ever known, and I still compare others to him in conversation. And then we jump all the way over to BC connection. Barry Forsyth is now in BC. Was a young guy here, some of you will know him. Mentored by my dad, gave leadership here, ended up being at the church my dad was in Sherbrooke, and now is in BC. His last week, not only did John Vissers, but others, and Barry Forsyth had the privilege of speaking to Dad his last week before he died. And when I called John Barry back when Dad passed away, John simply talked about the influence that Dad had had on his life as a friend, as a mentor, and in ministry. Dad loved people, and people loved Dad, loved Granddad. He had a passionate influence on young people in ministry, and yet Dad wants us to give God the credit, even though he is pleased that we recognize his passion. Now I want to jump to some of our family memories. As we were talking as kids, some of the things that I and we remember, do you guys remember the old skates that we put on that Dad would lace up for us? Pioneer Camp, drop off and pick up. Getting the big Christmas tree, whether in Sherbrooke or here in Toronto. Year after year, the Santa Claus parade, trips to the CNE, summer up at the farm, and the list goes on and on. I learned how to throw a perfect spiral from Dad during our trip as kids to visit Uncle Neil. I want to read just a couple of quotes from a couple of family members. Some of family members have chosen to keep their thoughts to themselves. Others have written in, and I'm just going to read them. Ian and Peter, my nephew Peter here, and brother Ian. Peter remembers Granddad making his sandwiches in grade 9 when we were staying at their farm in 2005 after our first move to Ontario. We were in the midst of kitchen renovations at our house, so we were still eating suppers at Grandma and Granddad's place. Peter remembers Granddad very carefully and neatly folding the wax paper to wrap his school sandwiches after supper. Ian remembers his dad doing the same things years before. Dad would help us kids make our school lunches and carefully fold the wax paper to wrap our sandwiches. Those were the days where saran wrap and microwave, before saran wrap and microwave lunches. Peter also remembers his granddad sitting on the John Deere lawnmower, cutting the grass at the farm. Granddad always wore his sun hat and sunglasses during that task, and he seemed quite content doing it. The dogs were also very special to Granddad and obedient to Granddad as he called out, "Porch, porch," in his strong voice to get them to run back to the door after they'd been romping around the yard. Aired. My favorite. Sure. Okay, so we got a bit of brother competition going on here, okay? Thanks for the reminder. In fact, you may want to go to Aird's and see his Massey's that he's got lined up now. Aird, you have got a wonderful thought of Dad. My favorite recent memory of Dad was how he loved to look out at the scenery of my farm when the sun was coming up, and he would quote a Bible verse and the day of the day and tell me how he appreciated living there. And we would chat about the news of the day while we enjoyed our morning coffee together. We did this for 6 years, and I miss him. Roger. Roger is a man of few words, but very special words, as all the other brothers are. Roger simply says, "I'm where I am today because I had two parents who loved me and prayed for me." There's so much more we can say about Dad. So much more about his love for his wife. I said that to my dad 2 weeks before he passed away. I said, "We men need better examples in this world of how to treat women." Amen. And I will say this, that my dad showed incredible, beautiful love and respect for my mom, Ruth McCombie. And I will cherish that. And I will try my best to do the same to my lovely wife. Dad does not want us to think that he was perfect. In fact, I had a great conversation with him with regard to adoption, and we said we were talking about adoption, and we talked about how beautifully biblical this whole idea of adoption is and how messy it is. Both together. It's beautiful and it's messy. Family is beautiful, and family is messy. And Dad knew that. And if there's something that I learned about my dad and my son Malachi told me yesterday, one of the words that we would describe Dad as being was humble. As strong a leader as he was, I came to know in my later years that my dad was this confident, humble man that was able to say, "I'm sorry," and to accept my apology. He was a humble man. He was a man that, on one hand, was delighted that people thought well of him, and yet, on the other hand, shied away from any sense that we would be drawing any glory away from what God had done in his life. So it is worth saying that even though Mom and Dad were not perfect, God blessed them for taking the risk in a day when it was not fashionable to adopt six from different nationalities. Two very quick stories. My granddad took a beating at work, verbally, because of what my parents did. My dad lost friends because of what they did to adopt us. And that, for me, takes away any sense of focusing on the imperfections that someone would sacrifice for me. I want to end with Dad's greatest love, God, Jesus Christ. As I said, Dad did not want the glory. He wanted Jesus to have the glory. And he made it his aim to let people know that the good news was real. Jill tells me that Dad told her that at the beginning, when he started his therapy, he started his treatments at the hospital, at the care home at Lasard House, that he was going to find every avenue to point others to Jesus, that seeds would be planted and would grow. And Jill leaves us with this thought. In the same way, I tell you, there is much rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. That was Dad's heart. In his last days, we had many conversations about his accomplishments. And when I used the phrase that God was waiting for him to say, "Well done, good and faithful servant," Dad wept. And he said to myself and some of our siblings, "Feet of clay, feet of clay. We all have feet of clay." And it is my belief that because my dad was who he was, as imperfect as he was, he is now looking into the eyes of a most loving God and hearing those words, "Well done. Well done, my son, my faithful servant." Father, grandfather, friend, and pastor, I don't ask that you rest in peace, because you are in the arms of a most loving God. Amen. And amen.
Well, I'm sitting back there realizing it was 1975 when I probably first stood behind this pulpit. It was 1975 that I came up from Knox College to be interviewed by Alex for the position of his youth pastor. And I found out from Alex in conversation years later, his impression was, he'll do, he'll do. And I'm here to say today that I wouldn't, first of all, even be here today if it wasn't for Alex McCombie. And it is a great mantle to carry, but I never had a man think more of me and support me and my wife Marilyn than Alex and Ruth McCombie. I never did my ministry textbook style, but every time I was an absolute wreck, Alex would be there and would restore things. And I am very honored to be here today to read the scripture, to say the prayer. Just a few scripture that I have chosen. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train of his robe filled the temple. Isaiah worked very closely with King Uzziah. Between the two of them, they brought great spiritual and financial blessing to Israel. As long as King Uzziah was on the throne, Isaiah had a peaceful ministry. So when the year King Uzziah died, did Isaiah fall apart? No, he sought the Lord. Alex McCombie was my King Uzziah. As I told you, it always amazes me that he would support me the way he did. I was a diamond in the rough, but he did let on. The last time Marilyn and I visited him, he said, "Oh, Jim, when you came from Knox, I wondered what I had done." Said, "You couldn't tie a tie. You looked a mess. I had to have two or three elders put you together before you got to the service." And he was my King Uzziah. And you know, he was all of our King Uzziahs. I think the number that he and Ruth worked out, where there were 14 different men and women that he influenced into the Christian ministry. And John and I are two remnants of all that. He was a King Uzziah to many of us because he brought us peace and comfort. You know, the words that Gavin said, that was Alex through and through. So he would not want any of us to feel defeated today, to just say, we got to give it all up. No, he would want us to seek the Lord. And Alex, as he lay in that hospice, spoke this scripture so strongly. For me, to live is Christ, and to die is only gain. And again, if we just go on a little further in Philippians, I think there's a word here to the family today. When Ruth died, her funeral was at my church in Markdale. And you know, I was never one of the sharpest tools in the book that Alex had worked with. But at the end, I was his pastor. I thought, that's pretty damn good. Yeah. Sorry, Alex. But to his family, the scripture says, I am hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary on your account. I know from talking with Alex, all through Ruth's sickness and passing, and through his own last years, as we shared, he was ready for heaven. And I shared this with Aird one day. I said, you know, your dad wants to go home. And Aird said, we're not ready to give him up yet. And you know, that's what Alex did. He went through the treatment. He did that for his family, so you could have that time with him. And what did God give you? A beautiful time, over a month, to just concentrate on your father and be with him. I think another verse that Alex exemplified, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Let us pray. Teach me to do your will, for you are my God. Let your good spirit lead me on level ground. Lord, we can hear Alex saying those words to you. Alex was the one that taught us these things, how to live on level ground. We saw his godly habits, and they were the theme of his life. Father, he didn't lecture people. He just lived out Christ. And we here today all have had that golden opportunity to stand back and watch Christ flow out of Alex's life. And we learn so much, not by him sitting down and specifically laying everything out, but just by osmosis, watching a man of God working out his salvation with all fear and trembling. For your sake, O Lord, preserve my life. In your righteousness, bring my soul out of trouble. And in your steadfast love, you will cut off all my enemies, and you will destroy all the adversaries of my soul, for I am your servant. For those of us here today, being able to officiate in this service, Father, we are humbled and we are honored to be here. And each of us wants just a little bit more of that passion that Alex McCombie had when he preached the Word of God, when he lived the Word of God, when he was with his family, when he was with anyone and wanted to introduce them to the best thing in his life, the Lord Jesus Christ. Many of us, Father, are very touched by Alex McCombie and by the love of a great couple, Alex and Ruth. We are thankful for them. And for them being a part of our lives. Father, you took care of us through Alex and Ruth. And Lord, when you sought Alex to be your servant, you probably would have used Isaiah's words, "You are my servant. I have chosen you and not cast you out. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." Lord, at the time of Ruth's passing, I remember hearing Alex say to Ruth, "Ruth, I want to go with you." And then what did he do? He taught us how to soldier on, not missing a beat, not a step out of place, when the love of his life had died. Lord, may we have that passion and that kind of faith and that wonderful hope, because Alex knew Ruth and he would be together again. Lord, none of us here have been to heaven. We have not moved beyond the grave. We don't know what heaven is really like. But we know and are pretty sure that Alex and Ruth are now experiencing it together, the joy and the rest that remains for the people of God. As Alex would say, "But for me it is good to be near God. I have made the Lord God my refuge, that I may tell of all of your works." Lord, for us, it was good to see Alex live near his Heavenly Father, to walk into any situation confidently as a conqueror in Christ, always having plan A and then B and C, always seeming to know what to do because he was so directed by your love. And now, Father, for Alex, the loving father of Ian with Ruth Lynn, of Aird and Roger and Stephen and Mary, of Trevor, of Gavin and Fern, of Jane, of Jill, and Paul. Like at the Queen's passing, when they took the crown and the royal banners off the casket so the family could have time with their mother, we pray for Alex's family, for his children and their partners and their children. We pray for them as they take this time as a family, not to mourn a great preacher, not to mourn a wonderful pastor, a churchman, an elder, a leader, but to mourn their father, Dad. Comfort and be with them now. And as one who sat, Father, Sunday after Sunday at the McCombie Sunday dinner table, these lives that were around that table and that were around Alex in his trying times, who never forsook him, who were always near to them, they are precious lives. And now they're presiding over their own families, all having been raised by the Ruth and Alex McCombie playbook. Father, they mourn, but not as a family that has no hope. So, Lord, we thank you. We thank you for the touch of Alex. We thank you that we will be able to carry on our conversations with him, run and greet him when we all get to glory. And that is a sure thing. And how do we know that? We know that by the cross, and we know that by Alex's faith in the cross of Jesus Christ. So, Father, we say it here today. Well done, thy good and faithful servant. Enter into the rest, Alex, that has been prepared for you from all eternity. And we ask it in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Now, I'm not the long-winded preacher today. That's John's duty. But I do have to read his scriptures. And these are the ones that he and Alex discussed. A favorite of Alex, Psalm 73, verses 23 to 29. Nevertheless, I am continually with you. You hold my right hand. You guide me with counsel. And afterwards, you receive me up to glory. Whom have I in heaven but you? And there is nothing on earth that I desire besides you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. And then over in John chapter 14, the first six verses. Let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to be with myself. Where I am, you may be also. And you know the way to where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? And Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. And then in 2 Corinthians, a passage that I know Alex wanted read. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that the surpassing power belongs to God and not to us. So we do not lose heart, though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self is being renewed day by day. For this light, momentary affliction is preparing us for the eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. As we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. For the things that are unseen are transient, but the things that, sorry, I got that wrong. Rather crucial spot there, John, sorry. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are not seen are eternal. For we know that if the tent that is our earthly home is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, but eternal in heaven. For in this tent we groan, longing to put on our heavenly dwelling. If indeed by putting it on, we may not be found naked. For while we are still in this tent, we groan, being burdened, not that we would be unclothed, but that we would be further clothed, so that the mortality can be swallowed up by life. He who has prepared us for this very thing is God, who has given us a spirit as a guarantee. So we are always of good courage. We know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. Yes, we are of good courage. And we would rather be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please him. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. And may God add his blessing to the reading of his word.
We could not have a memorial service or a funeral service for Alec McCombie without an exposition of scripture and without a sermon. And so that's my task this morning, not so much to talk about Alec, but to talk about Alec's Savior. And as we prepare to look at scripture together and as we hear the word of God, as it's been read, and as we listen to it together, let's pray and seek the presence of God. Father, we thank you for our time together already this day in this place to share together in this service. We pray that you would be with us and give us attention of mind and spirit and heart as we open your word and hear your word preached and expounded to us. Prepare our hearts, O Lord, to receive your word, and silence within us any voice but your own voice, that hearing that word, we may also obey your will for our lives. Through Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen. Friends, this is, of course, a very tender moment for all of us. It's a moment that's filled with some sadness, a moment that's filled with a keen sense of loss, but also a moment, I think, that fills us with hope and with faith and with love. A lot of love has been shared here already today. We're gathered here to celebrate and to give thanks for our brother in Christ, the Reverend Alec McCombie, but more importantly, we're here really to bear witness to the everlasting life in Jesus Christ, which was the center of Alec's faith, the center of Alec's life, and the center of his ministry. I want to begin today by, first of all, thanking Sean Howard and the good people of St. Andrews, Islington, for hosting this service. For over 15 years, Alec was, as you've heard, the pastor here. He loved this congregation, and this congregation loved him. And I don't think any of us will ever fully grasp how full and fruitful his ministry here was for the kingdom of God. I met Alec for the first time when I was a kid of 10 years old, and he has had such an influence on my life. Lives were changed as men and women and young people and children came to know Jesus Christ as their Savior and as their Lord, and to grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord. I also want to say a word of thanks to Jim for his words and for the privilege of preaching here this morning. Jim, as you've heard, has been Alex's pastor for the last number of years. But finally, I want to thank the entire McCombie family. I want to thank you for the privilege of preaching today. I want to thank the Reverend Gavin McCombie for his powerful words of witness on behalf of the family. And I want to say to you, and I think I said this at your mother's funeral, I want to say to all of you how much we deeply appreciate and how much I appreciate the ways in which you shared your parents' with others, with all of us in their ministries, and I know that was not always easy. He was so proud of all of you. Gavin, your father, be so proud of what you did and said here today, as he was proud of all of his family, his children, his grandchildren, his great-grandchildren, and how much he loved his beloved wife, Ruth, who went to be with the Lord some 5 years ago. During the past 10 months or so, when it became clear that Alex was not well, he and I visited about 5 or 6 times, and we talked, and we reminisced, and we prayed, and we laughed. Alec never lost a sense of humor right to the end. One of the things we did was last December, he came to visit me in my office, the principal's office at Knox College. And he wanted to do that because the only other time he'd ever been in the principal's office at Knox College was when he was in trouble. And so he wanted to meet with the principal of Knox College when he wasn't in trouble. And we had a great time, Aaron and Alec and I, that day. But one of the things we talked most about in the times we were together was his hope in Christ, his belief in heaven, the promise of everlasting life. Alec, and I say this, and I cannot say this about many people, he did not fear death. He did not welcome it, but he did not fear it. He did not want to hasten it. He didn't really look forward to dying, but he did not fear death. He was fond of quoting D.L. Moody, who once said, "When you hear that Moody has died, don't believe it. I will be more alive than ever before. Death may be the king of terrors," said Moody, "but Jesus is the king of kings." When I was a student minister here working with Alec in the late 70s after Jim had been in that position, he gave me, that is, Alec gave me a book of lectures for students written by C.H. Spurgeon. And he especially liked one of Spurgeon's quotes in particular, a piece of advice for preachers. And it went like this: "When you preach about heaven, your face should light up with the glory of God. And when you preach about hell, well, then your everyday face will do." So this morning, for a few moments at least, I want to preach about heaven because that's what Alec wanted. And I pray somehow in these moments, in this service, that the glory of God will radiate in this place. Alec believed deeply in what the Christian faith teaches about what happens when he dies, when we die. When he was in palliative care in the hospice, we talked about the hope of everlasting life, the hope of the resurrection of the body, the new heaven and the new earth, the life that is to come for the people of God, presence and rest in the immediate presence of God, the hope of heaven that is ours, where Jesus is at the right hand of the Father. And one of the things that I so deeply appreciate about Alex in my life as a friend, mentor, and really as my spiritual father is that I was supposed to be, I suppose, ministering to him at the end, but he was ministering to me. He was teaching me as much or even more than I was teaching him. And so we chose these passages together, which Jim has read for us. Psalm 73, whom have I in heaven but you? My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion. And 2 Corinthians 5:1, for we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. And verse 8, yes, we have this confidence, and we would rather be away from the body and at home with the Lord. And then the wonderful words that are often read at many funerals from John chapter 14, where Jesus is preparing his disciples for his departure. He is preparing them for his death. This is part of what is known as the upper room discourse, and Jesus is teaching his disciples that there's a cross coming, his death is coming, he will be put in a tomb, and on the third day he will be raised again, and after 40 days he will ascend into heaven and sit at the right hand of the Father. And so in all of these passages, Alex and I talked together, and we talked about what is this hope that we have? What is this heaven that we believe in? What is this promise that is held out before us? What do we learn from these words of Jesus and these words of the psalmist and these words of the apostle Paul? Well, if you knew Alec well and you sat under his ministry, you also knew that he almost always preached three-point sermons. And so I'm going to preach in that honored tradition this morning briefly, but I want to say three things about heaven, about our hope in heaven, about our hope for everlasting life. And to make Alec proud, I'm even going to use alliteration. So there you go. 3 points. First of all, it's clear from what Scripture teaches that heaven is a place. It's real. Jesus says to his disciples, do not let your hearts be troubled. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. And the word that is used here by Jesus is translated in English, the word that's translated as place in English in verses 2, 3, and 4 is the word that means I go to prepare a place for you. It means a room or an abode or a dwelling place, or we might even say, as it does in some translation, in my Father's house are many mansions, or we might think of an expansive place, but it is real, and it is imagine to be a place where we might live and where we might flourish. What do we actually think heaven is going to be like? One thing we know for sure, whatever heaven is like, it will be so much more than we can ever hope or imagine. That's because it is an eternal place. It is hard for us to understand because it transcends our space and our time. It is a heavenly and an angelic reality created by God. It transcends the universe. It is before and beyond the Big Bang. It cannot be contained by the dimensions within which we now live as creatures. And if you read the Bible and are sometimes puzzled by its language, it's because the language of the Bible, even itself, our earthly language, strains to capture the majesty and the mystery of what life eternal will be. It's trying to describe through a pictorial representation the transcendent dwelling of God and what that life is like in God's immediate presence without any obstacles, without any doubt. Hebrews 12:22 describes it this way, but you have come to Mount Zion and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to innumerable angels in the festival gathering together, and to the assembly of the firstborn, and to God, the judge of all, and the spirits of the righteous made perfect. And the Bible ends in Revelation chapter 21 and chapter 22 with this marvelous picture of a new heaven and a new earth, and it's trying to describe something that we can't even fully comprehend, except that there will be no more tears. Death will be no more. No more crying and mourning and pain. All things, the messiness of all of life, will be reconciled. Enough water for all, life for all, light for all, worship and joy and fellowship forever. The heavenly reality, heaven will be a place of perfect fellowship, of right relationships, a place of truth and reconciliation and justice, a place of rest and unity, where there will be no more anxiety, no more depression, no more anger, no more shame, no more resentment. It will all come together in the presence of God. Heaven is not only a place, friends, it is a promise, and it is a sure promise to the followers of Jesus. It's a promise made by Jesus to his disciples, and through them a promise made to all followers. Don't be worried or anxious, says Jesus. You believe in God. He's affirming their faith in God, and now he says, believe also in me. Trust me. I am going ahead to my Father. I am going to God. I am going to prepare a place for you. It's a promise. It's also the promise made by the Apostle Paul to the Corinthian Christians in the midst of all of their struggles and all of their conflicts and all of their divisions and all of the things that made their lives messy. Paul promised that there would be this reality ahead. And it's a promise claimed by the psalmist when he felt alone and abandoned and when his life was ebbing away. Whom have I in heaven but you? The promise that Jesus makes. Now, friends, I want to ask a question this morning. The question is, why does this promise really matter? It matters because it's really the basis of our hope in life and in death. Some people may hear the words that I'm saying in this sermon this morning and say, well, you know, that's fine. That's just pie in the sky. I mean, you're a preacher. That's what you're supposed to say at a funeral. You're supposed to preach about everlasting life. That's not a real promise. That's just a pious platitude to make everyone who's gathered together feel good. That's what preachers are supposed to do at funerals, aren't they? It doesn't really mean anything for me here and now, because really there is no God. If you knew my life, preacher, you would know that there cannot possibly be a God. There's nothing after death. There is no heaven. We are left here to our own devices. That's it. And if you're here today and you have thoughts like this, I plead with you to just listen a little. We all have questions about life. And those questions bubble to the surface at various times, and they often bubble to the surface at times like this. We all have questions about ultimate reality. We may not ask these questions a lot. We may not all ask them in the same way, but all of us, at some time in our lives, ask these questions. Because that's what it means to be human. Why am I here? Is there really any meaning to my life? Why is my life so hard? Why does it seem that things aren't the way they're supposed to be? Why is there something rather than nothing? Why is the universe so vast? Why, when I look out into the starry night, I see stars that no longer exist anymore. I'm simply seeing the light and the rays of vast galaxies millions of years ago, of stars that have already died out. Am I nothing more than a small speck in a vast universe that really has no meaning? Why do I have this longing in my heart for something more? Why do I so often feel like I'm homesick? What happens? What happens when I die? Do I just return to the dust of the earth? Will my friends and family simply gather and have a service to recognize me and then put me in the ground, have some sandwiches afterwards, and that's it? Is that what life comes to? What can I really believe? What can I really hope? These questions all have to do with God. Jesus says, you believe in God, believe also in me. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Don't be anxious. You know, some people think that belief in God and trust in Jesus is an incredible act of faith. I have to say that there's something more audacious in my mind intellectually, and that is that it takes more faith to me not to believe in God in the face of these questions. That's the hard truth. Nothing else and no one else can answer these questions for yourself but you. And Alec McCombie spent his life preaching a gospel of Jesus Christ that he believed with all of his heart and with all of his mind and with all of his soul, addressed those questions and promised people life. Believe in God, says Jesus, believe also in me. It's a word we can trust. It's a promise which speaks to our heart's deepest longing, to our heart's deepest grief, to our heart's deepest fear. It's a promise that matters. Thomas A Kempis says, without a way, there is no going. Without the truth, there is no knowing. And without the life, there is no living. Jesus said, I am the way, and I am the truth, and I am the life. Which brings me really to the final point and the last thing I want to say at this service, and that is, when all is said and done, yes, heaven is this wonderful place, it is this promise held out by Jesus, but more than anything else, it's a person. It is the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. And one of the things Alex said to me in one of the times we met is, one of the reasons I may be afraid of dying, but I'm not afraid of death, is because when I walk through death's door, I know who will be there to welcome me home. And his name is Jesus. Psalm 73, verse 25 again says, whom have I in heaven but you? The Lord Jesus Christ. Hebrews 12, 1 and 2 says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, that is, those who have died and gone before us, the saints of glory, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely, and let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us. And what does the writer say? Looking to Jesus, the pioneer. The pioneer who's gone on ahead, the perfecter of our faith, who for the sake of the joy that was set before him endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of God. In Revelation 21, 22, the writer, pointing to Jesus, says, I am the Alpha and I am the Omega. I am the beginning and I am the end. It all starts and it all finishes with me, Jesus, the bright and morning star. During my last visit with Alec, and again, I want to thank the family so much for the privilege of having as many visits as I did with him in the last weeks. During the last visit, and Gavin was there, and Lynn, my wife, was with me. We visited together. We read scripture as we always did. Lynn actually prayed for him on that occasion, and I gave him one of my favorite quotes from John Bunyan's Pilgrim's Progress. For those who don't know Pilgrim's Progress, it's a kind of classic, and it's an allegory about a man named Christian who sets out on a journey toward Mount Zion, the celestial city. And it's a challenging journey, and it's filled with pitfalls and challenges and struggles and pain and setbacks, difficult terrain to navigate. And yet, in the midst of it all, he perseveres. He perseveres on. And at one point in the story, a woman named Prudence poses a series of questions to Christian as to why he's even doing this. And she poses this question to him: Christian, and what is it that makes you so desirous to go to Mount Zion? What is it that makes you so desirous to go to Mount Zion? And Christian says this: why, there I hope to see him alive that did hang dead on the cross. And there I hope to be rid of all those things that to this day are in me an annoyance to me. There they say there is no death, and there I shall dwell with such company as I like best. For to tell you truth, I love him because I was by him eased of my burden, and I am weary of my inward sickness. I would fain be where I shall die no more, and with the company that shall continually cry, holy, holy, holy. If I may quote the first question of the Heidelberg Catechism for us this morning: what is our only comfort in life and in death? As you're at this funeral today, what is your comfort? What is your assurance in life and in death? The answer of the Heidelberg Catechism is this: that in life and in death, I belong, body and soul, not to myself, but to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ, who at the cost of his own life did take up all my sin and brought me salvation and assures me of eternal life. Friends, I've known Alec McCombie for 55 of my 65 years on this earth. And there's a lot of things I'm sure I don't know about him and never knew about him. But this one thing I know for sure: this was his faith. And his deepest longing, his deepest heart's desire, was that men, women, young people, and children, family, friends, that anyone who came to know him or whom he knew would also come to know his Savior. May that faith be our faith this day. Amen. Let us pray. Father, thank you this morning for this word to us. Thank you for the words that have been shared by so many for memories. But we give you thanks that we have this word of assurance this morning. And we pray that in the midst of our own lives, whatever our need is this morning, whatever our challenges, whatever our faith, that we might indeed know the assurance of your love, grace in Jesus Christ to us. For it's in his name we pray. Amen. Friends, the hymn is "To God Be the Glory."
To God.
Now, Lord, let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. Our eyes have seen the salvation which you have prepared in the sight of every people, a light to reveal you to the nations and the glory of your people Israel. And now, friends, the love of God our Father, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the comfort and presence of the Holy Spirit rest and abide upon each one of you, not just this day, but forevermore. Amen.